Welcome, everybody at this Tirzicht talk. And what I would like to do today is to explain a little bit about the Zero Hunger Lab and the research we are doing. But before that, I was my screen is yeah. So I was thinking about the audience, and also what Emil explained in the beginning about, let's say, what do we try to achieve with these Tirzicht talks. And I was thinking of Marie, because we have one thing in common. In these weeks, we are both moving to a new house. And to avoid rumors, we are not moving to the same house, because Eric would not appreciate that. But I sent this picture to Marie and Eric last week, because we are moving, they are moving. And then I got a reaction back, oh, that's typical logistic modeling operations research approach. Okay, I thought, but how would Eric and Marie move? So then I thought it must be something like this. And so it's a kind of artificial, and so on the left is Eric, and in the front is Marie. But I think it is very good to bring together all these let's say these expertises which we have at Tilburg University. And that's also part of the reason why I said yes to Emil when he asked me for this talk. Because Emil explained about the ELSA labs. And as a Zero Hunger Lab, we want to establish an ELSA lab in this year or next year or maybe the year after. But what we find important is that it's very multidisciplinary. And that's also what the Tirzicht talks are about. And I hope with this talk that I can at least, I'm going to explain a little bit what we are doing, but I hope that you find angles that you say, hey, this relates to my research, and then please refer to me. Yeah, then over to the more serious part, hunger. Hunger is one of the most challenging problems we have at this moment. It's nearly 700 million people go to bed hungry tonight. And as Marie already mentioned, it's raising at this moment. It's not decreasing. It has been decreasing for 15 years. And the last 3 years, it's climbing again. And the really real thing is that a lot of children are dying. And so every 10 seconds, a child dies of hunger. So after my talk, three classrooms of children have died. So that's really, we need really to do something about it. In the past 10 years, I've devoted my research really to work on applying data science, and especially my background is operations research, to do something for the world. And I was very happy with the sustainable development goals. And number two is on zero hunger. Number one is poverty. Number two is zero hunger. And what we do in the Zero Hunger Lab is what we call bites for bites. And so we want to help. We are not going to ourselves to Africa, but we want to help, let's say, NGOs, the United Nations, governments to reduce hunger in the world. So let them work better. So what I would like to do today is briefly meet the Zero Hunger Lab, show you our research focus areas, and in the end, a little bit on how you might help. So this is our team. We are rapidly expanding. What you see on the left, you see the SDGs. So this is number two, and there are 17 in total. And this is what we are trying to help. The young girl, it's a Yazidi girl. We cannot help her personally, but we can help children like her. And what we try to do in the Zero Hunger Lab, and that's important, we try to find the balance between science and impact. And so our research, we want it to be impactful. And I'll show you later some of the results we already achieved. So what this is about is the following. So we have, let's say, data and algorithms. I don't need to explain in this group. We want to come to solutions and advice for our the partners with whom we work, most of the time NGOs, sometimes governments, and often also the UN. And we want to come to better decisions. And the better decisions might be on emergency relief. That's what you see on the left. That's when a disaster strikes, an earthquake, a flood, and whatever. But what we think is more important is on the sustainable development. And we want also to help there. And we can do a lot there, because the final solution of hunger in this world will be that societies can take care of themselves, yes? And also climate resistance, resistant, and these kind of things. And so we want to help there. And so our main focus at this moment is data and algorithms. Maybe in the future, we will expand it in the ELSA way, also with law and ethics and the behavioral science. But for now, this is what we are doing. We have four main themes, and I will show you a little bit some examples. I will not go into detail because time is short for that. But if you are interested, please come to me. We have emergency relief. That's where we originated. We are working on detecting malnutrition. We are working on healthy diets for a healthy planet, and we are working on food system resilience. Now, if I look to emergency supply chain optimization, this has much to do with the work which we have been doing over the past 10 years with the United Nations World Food Programme. And they are based in Rome. And what we do there is we develop solutions to make relief aid very efficient and effective. And we do that by mathematical optimizations. Think of my boxes and moving to a house. You want to do that as efficient as possible. And the impact we try to achieve is saving lives by as many people we can help, or within the same funding. And now, some examples. Our work started with the World Food Programme. We started some 10 years ago. It has been a lot of work. We have worked with five master thesis students from Tilburg University, one PhD. And we have worked for many years, and WFP has invested a lot in it. They have built up their own group of analytical people over these 10 years. And the nice thing is, from a science perspective, we won the Franz Edelman Award this year with this work. But from an impact, and that's the head of science impact balance, from an impact perspective, we were also very happy because. What we achieved there in this 10 year is that they saved, let's say, so many money that they can feed 2 million people for an entire year with the same funding they have today. And so that's really, and I think, and the nice thing is when you hear these managers talking at the United Nations, they say this is only the beginning. And then I think by myself, yes, these people understand even more than some of the Western companies what data science, what artificial intelligence is about. We not only work for Africa, we also work for the Dutch food banks, because we also want to do something nearby. And we are working on several aspects. So for example, to forecast how many people are eligible for food banks. And we are also, of course, also looking to their logistics and how they could invest optimally in spending their money also best. And the final one in this category is we have last year, we have worked on the optimal response depots. Maybe you know that worldwide, there are six humanitarian response depots. So whenever a disaster strikes, so take for example Haiti a few weeks ago, then immediately these depots are opened and immediately the flow starts of all kinds of goods, tents, water, food. And we have looked at the position of these depots and we could mathematically show that they are not at the right location. So you can be much faster at a disaster if they are positioned differently. Of course, there's also a lot of politics behind. I won't bother you with that. But these are the things which we do in emergency relief. And further, we are also working on detecting malnutrition. And that is also work which we do together with the faculty of THHD and also with Eric Posma. So we develop artificial intelligence solutions to quickly determine malnutrition. You should really imagine that in Africa or wherever in South America, that the mother with her children, and often there are very many children, they have to go to a medical post. Then these children are weighted and they are measured and all kinds of things to detect the malnutrition. So it is a lot of effort for all these families, but it's also a huge claim on the medical sector. A lot of doctors and nurses are needed for that. So Welthungerhilfe, that's a big German organization in helping to reduce hunger, they asked us to help on, let's say, they had an idea of making a kind of picture or a small movie of a child, and that from that movie, with artificial intelligence, neural networks, and these kind of things, we can immediately detect whether a child is malnutrition, or maybe we can already separate 80-90%, and that would already help tremendously. This is also one that could have a tremendous effect in the world, because there are very many organizations looking for this. Also UN, but many NGOs, they are also facing it. And also Medicines Without Frontiers and all these kind of organizations are looking for these kind of solutions. A third research line is the healthy diet for a healthy planet. In a lot of situations, you can use artificial intelligence techniques to compose a very healthy diet, but we are also looking to make that, sometimes you can calculate that, but then the diet is not affordable, or the diet is very environmentally unfriendly. And so we need to really find these diets and compositions of diets have people that say, let them have a regional good way of feeding themselves. And we have here as partners, again, the World Food Program, Capgemini and Johns Hopkins, where we work together. And this should impact many of the policymakers and NGOs who are looking for some software model to help them in, and especially in low and mid-income countries. But also we can use this in, let's say, in many neighborhoods in the West, where we know that the diet patterns are in fact very bad. And the fourth and final line is food system resilience. That's what I explained in the beginning. Hunger will in the end be reduced when we can develop resilient food systems. And the funny thing is, when you look from a research perspective, an algorithmic perspective, let's say the solutions and the algorithms really resemble the ones which we use in emergency aid, because you don't have to procure food, you have to grow food. And so there's a kind of agricultural aspect into it. And this is one we are currently setting up and working out. This one is not as far as the other three, but this will be an important one for the future. So we have worked on the sustainable palm oil with Solidaridad. We have looked at the effectivity of cash programs, because more and more relief organizations are giving cash to people instead of food or items. And we have found some very interesting results, because SOA had a very nice database of a lot of households, and we were able to analyze that and draw interesting conclusions. And the final one is from where we work with Oxfam on the so-called digital diversity wheel. And there we advise farmers via a mobile app in Zimbabwe what kind of crops they should grow. They know we should grow maize, but then there are 15 types of maize, and which one is now the best that grows in their area, given the amount of, given the soil, given the amount of rain, given the amount of sun, and these kind of things. I know it's a rush, a lot of things. I hope you have found some connections or something that you say, hey, that's interesting, that might relate to my research. We cannot eliminate hunger on our own, and we need to do that with a lot of people, a lot of research, and a lot of organizations. And so I think we need all your expertise. I already mentioned it, it's machine learning, ethics, behavioral sciences, law, and many of these things also mentioned by Emil, we have it at our university. And we want to expand our lab to include these domains of expertise. So I hope to hear from you in the future. Thank you very much for your attention.